For greater things, there's no power like the power of Jesus. So let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe, come on. For greater things, there's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe, come on. For greater things, there's no power.
Good morning, church family. There we go. There we go. I think we'll go ahead and do that again this morning. Good morning, church family. There we go. Happy Thanksgiving week to everybody this morning. We're glad that you have made it over here today. I tell our students this all the time. On a morning like this, you easily could be laying in bed at home, right? But you chose to be here today in the house of the Lord to worship the King of Kings, and we're grateful for that. So we're grateful that you've chosen to worship with us today. First and foremost, if you happen to be visiting with us today, we'd love to connect with you. Take that connect card that you can find on the back of your pew, back of the pew in front of you. If you have some time during the service today, fill that out, drop it in the offering plate before you leave this morning. We'd love to connect with you and your family. But today, we believe anytime that we come into the house of the Lord, we believe that he has something great in store. But first and foremost, let us get our hearts prepared to worship him completely. So I invite you where you are, if you are able, to stand with me. I'm going to open this up in a word of prayer as we go before the Lord together. Would you pray with me? Lord, we come before you today grateful for your mercies that are new each day. And today, as we gather on a day that is rainy, kind of dreary outside, Lord, you bring light and life, and you bring joy. And Lord, we ask today that first and foremost, you would be honored by our praise, be honored by our song, be honored by the study of your word. And Lord, we do pray that if there's anybody here today that doesn't know you, that today would be the day of salvation. Would you save souls in this place this morning? But as we prepare to worship, Lord, we ask that you would search our hearts, see if there be any grievous way in us, so that as we lift your praises, you are honored from a pure heart. We're asking you to move in a great way this morning. Be glorified in this room today. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's worship together. Been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom comes, will your robes be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the nations bright? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Beside the garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed
washed in the blood of the Lamb.
This morning, let us continue to celebrate and worship together. Turn, greet a new face here this morning.
As we continue in worship, I want to first of all thank a group of the youth specifically who helped us pack bags for our food pantry this morning. And my Sunday school class assisted in that, but the youth really took the initiative in that regard. So thank you for our youth group for doing that, because now we don't have to... Now we're not going to draw people out after eating our Thanksgiving meal to then go out and pack those bags. But we have our food pantry tomorrow. And so if you can come back and serve at our food pantry, that'd be fantastic. It's from 3:30 to 5:30 tomorrow afternoon. But in singing that song, "Have you been washed? Have you been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb?" It reminded me of Romans 8, verse 1. And it says this: "There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." And I just want us to think about this. It is great to give food to somebody, but it's better to give the bread of life. It's great to give water or a cup to drink to somebody, but it's best to give the water of life. And Jesus is the only way to eternal life. And so here at Exchange, we're all about Jesus, and we want to make much about Jesus, and we're all about connecting God's people with God's people as we all connect with God. And so I'm grateful you guys are here. I want to pray over us as we continue in worship and really just focus our minds on how amazing the gift of Jesus is for all of us, that sinners like us can be connected with a holy God. What a gift. Will you pray with me? Father, we thank you so much for this day that you made. We thank you so much for the opportunity to gather as your people in your name to confess your mighty works and your wonders. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the life that he lived. We thank you for the death that he was willing to go towards. He laid his life down, the perfect sinless life, dying in my place, in our place, a sinner's death, that we might have life and have life everlasting, that we might say as a congregation, "There is now therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Hallelujah. We lift up your name. We lift up praise to you, adoration. We bring you our worship, Father, because of Jesus. For it's all about Jesus. Lead us to the cross this morning, Father. Would you continue to lavish us with your grace and the presence of your Spirit as we are drawn to you. We need you. Oh, we need you every hour. We need you. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
See, on the hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. Look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from his side. No greater sacrifice.
Sing of what he's done.
What he's done. What he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven, and I praise God for what he's done. See, for the freedom he has won, Even death is dead in time. His life has overcome. Speak, say the name above all names. Over every broken place, He is risen from the grave. What He's done, what He's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven, and I praise God for what He's done. Now, on a throne of majesty, the Father's will complete. He reigns in victory.
We sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can breathe. Sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can breathe. And what He's done, what He's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven, and I praise God for what He's done, and I praise God for what He's done, and I praise God for what He's done.
We sing because He's worthy, and may we build our life upon the foundation of Christ's love. Sing worthy of every song we could ever sing.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for You. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for You.
Holy.
And holy, there is no one like You. There is none beside You. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who You are and fill me with Your heart and lead me in Your love to those.
May this be our prayer this morning, saying, I will build my life upon Your love, for it's a firm foundation.
And I will build my life upon Your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in You. I will build my life beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
As we continue this morning, we're going to turn our attention now to the price that was paid upon the cross of Christ. We are here today. We have the freedom to worship today because of the price paid on the cross for us. That we were once dead in our sin, dead in our trespasses, but now we have life, hope in Christ Jesus. Let's sing this morning.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. And through your grace, so free, washes over me. You have your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over. Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Sing, oh, your grace.
Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. Oh, it's your in my life began. can't. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested, my life began. When death was arrested, my life began. That's when death was arrested, my life began.
Dear Heavenly Father, what you've done for us is so amazing, Lord, and we are so thankful. And I just pray that we would remember, as we're going into this season of Thanksgiving, all of the things, all of the blessings, all of the life, all of the salvation and everything that you've done for us, the blood that's covered us and washed us clean, Lord. And I just pray that we would be thankful every moment that you've done this for us and that you've loved us this much, that you desire for us to have a relationship with you and to spend eternity with you, Lord. And so we're just very thankful today. Be with us as we go throughout this week, that we tell others about you and the things that we are thankful for that you've done for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
I invite you to remain standing where you are just for a brief moment. At this time, I'd like to dismiss our children who are 4 years old through the third grade. We do offer a children's church option for them during the preaching portion of our worship service. They can go with Miss Kathy there in the back, and they can be picked up in our children's wing immediately following our dismissal at the end of the day today. I would invite you to turn your attention to the screen for a moment. So one of the practices we like to do at Exchange is we like to read God's Word together before we dive into it. And today I'm going to bring you our passage or some context for our passage from Acts chapter 14. This is going to be verses 1 through 7 of Acts chapter 14. Now at Iconium, they entered together into the Jewish synagogue and spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and Greeks believed. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So they remained for a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord, who bore witness to the word of his grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. But the people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews and some with the apostles. When an attempt was made by both Gentiles and Jews with their rulers to mistreat them and to stone them, they learned of it and fled to Lystra and Derbe, cities of Lycaonia, and to the surrounding country. And there they continued to preach the gospel. You may be seated.
Father, we thank you for your word that is living and active, sharper than the two-edged sword. And I pray that today you'd hide me behind your cross, that your words would be proclaimed, words of life, words of hope, words of truth, that we would leave today edified, encouraged, molded, and shaped by your word. And Lord, we ask that if there's anyone here who does not know you as their Lord and Savior, they've not placed their faith and trust in you and committed their life to you, that today would be the day of salvation. May you open up their eyes to see the beauty of your gospel. May you open up their ears to hear the beauty of your voice. May you move as only you can, convicting the soul, piercing the heart, and leading unto salvation. We thank you for this day that you've made. We rejoice in it. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we are in Acts chapter 14, and we'll be examining the entire chapter. I just wanted Preston to read the first seven verses for us, because it actually gives us an overview of the entire chapter. And so we've been journeying through Acts, and as we've been journeying through Acts, we've been seeing that God has moved among men in a specific way. And so God moved among men by Jesus being born, and we celebrate normally that around Christmas and the birth of Christ into human history. And then Jesus walked on earth for 30-ish years, 30, 33 years, but he had a 3-year ministry time, and in that time, he made disciples. So he started his public ministry, and his family did not believe in him during that public ministry. They said, hey, stop being crazy. Come on home. Maybe some of your family have been that way. And he said, and he drew some other people to be his disciples. And these people left everything to follow him. And if you see this journey of their faith, it really took them years, the 3 years, to understand who Jesus was. But it wasn't until Acts when they received the Holy Spirit in the way they now have it. And so Jesus changed everything because he is the God-man. Jesus is God, but was born into human history, so he put on human flesh. So he is 100% God and 100% man, and he comes and walks on earth, and he lives perfectly. And I say this all the time, so if you've been here for a minute, you've probably heard it too much that you're sick of it. Jesus was perfect, which means you would have hated to have been his brother, or you would have hated to have him as your brother. Because your parents would have said, why can't you be more like Jesus? Why can't you act like Jesus? Well, I'm not God. But they couldn't make that claim. I don't know. Jesus was completely different, even before he started his public ministry. He had never sinned his entire life. He starts his public ministry, he shares about repentance, he shares about new life, he shares about the kingdom of God coming down to earth. He shares that he's going to have to die and raise from the dead. He shares all of this for 3 years. He goes to the cross and he is put to death, and then he raises from the dead 3 days later, changing everything, because he showed his power over Satan, he showed his power over sin, and he showed his power over death. So Jesus changed everything. And then he walked on earth after his resurrection for 40 days. He was on earth for 40 days, and he was teaching his disciples one main thing. And that thing was how to advance the kingdom of God on earth. It shares about that in Acts chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. He just taught them what it means to share about the kingdom of God advancing on earth. And then we have the rest of this book of Acts. And it's an illustration for us as a church. And it's an illustration for every church on how to advance the kingdom of God on earth. And so you might say, well, I don't feel equipped to advance the kingdom of God. Well, you have God. If you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have the same spirit that rose Jesus from the dead residing in you. And one of my favorite lines from a Keith Green song from back in the day, if you know Keith Green, it means you've been a Christian for a few years, or you had a dad who was a Christian back in the day. That's my case. One of my favorite lines from a Keith Green song is this: Jesus, or the Spirit of God, rose Jesus from the dead, but you won't even rise out of bed. Meaning you have the power residing in you that rose Jesus from the dead, but you won't get out of bed with the same power and purpose to live for his mission. So in the book of Acts, we see this church that has grown, this church that has grown, and it's advancing the kingdom. It's now advanced the kingdom in the sense that it grew throughout Jerusalem. It then grew in Judea and Samaria, and now it's sent out Paul and Barnabas to go on a mission trip. So Paul and Barnabas, they're on their first mission trip. Have there been missionaries previously? Not really. So they're paving a new trail. But I just want you to know something. The word missionary is not in the Bible. It's like the word Trinity is not in the Bible. We use them to describe things that are in the Bible. But what we have here is Paul and Barnabas, they are living as disciples of Jesus. And as a disciple of Jesus, they are now living on mission. So they're going and traveling, telling people about Jesus. They're starting churches and telling people about Jesus. They're doing these things and telling people about Jesus, that everywhere they go, they're telling people about Jesus. But that's not a specific role for a specific person. That's just being a disciple of Jesus. Because we have all been called in Matthew. We've all been called in John and in Mark and in Luke and in Acts to go ye therefore and make disciples. So everyone who knows Jesus is a disciple of Jesus. And every disciple of Jesus is to be a disciple maker. So here's the task at hand. How do you make disciples? How do I make disciples? How do we go out and actually share our faith? What do we do to be a good witness? So I want to pause and just say this. There were some guys, when I was in high school, there were some guys who tried out for the football team who would never play. And they were my favorite guys to come and do any tackling drill with, because no matter how many times they were tackled, they didn't set themselves upright. And you knew if they were going to come and tackle you, they weren't going to hit you hard. So I kind of strategically positioned myself to really look good when I tackle them and not be tackled too hard when they tackle me. But there are some guys who just want to wear the jersey. They knew they were never going to play. They're too slow. They didn't work out. They didn't work hard. They didn't remember the plays. I remember specifically, I went to a church camp during the middle of football camp, and so my coaches punished me by putting me on the scout team, though I was a starter. So I was the scout team center because I was the backup center at the time, starting right guard. And so I'm standing there. I got a 350-pounder. This is high school. 350-pounder to my right, 350-pounder to my left. Big old boys. The D-line are my best friends. They're all starters. They're like, these boys right here aren't going to do anything. We're all just going to triple team John. So I snap the ball. That's exactly what happens. And I look in my, you know, past the D lineman, because I'm just on ice skates, just doing this. I'm just getting blown up. And they're just looking back at me like this. What help were they? But were they football players? Were they wearing jerseys? But were they doing what they're supposed to do? They did not do their job. So I'm going to translate that back to Christianity. Can you be a Christian and have faith in Jesus Christ, but sit on the sidelines, being proud of your jersey, have the pads, have the knowledge, but never step on the field to play? Sadly, we have too many of those. Sadly, we do. And so my challenge for you today, my challenge as your pastor ongoingly, is to equip this church that we are full of full-time starters, always players, always going, always doing the mission that God has called you to do. Because we as a church are only as strong as our weakest link. So that means we all have to be engaged. We all have to be equipped. We all have to be ready to share our faith with those around us. So the purpose of this sermon is to examine six life-giving commitments to help you stay focused in your God-given purpose. Six life-giving commitments. So we're going to be looking at these today. And the first comes from verses 1 and 2. So the first commitment is this: share the good news of Jesus. And Preston already read this, but just to repeat what he said, now in Iconium they entered a Jewish synagogue and they spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and Greeks believed. But unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So Paul and Barnabas, they're on their missionary journey. Paul and Barnabas are going and sharing. But there's a couple things that I want you to see here from this text, some principles that can help you share the good news of Jesus. Where did Paul and Barnabas go? Any town that they entered, the first place they went to a synagogue. Why did they go to a synagogue? Because any Jew would believe the Old Testament. They could use the Old Testament to then show that the Messiah that they're looking for, the prophesied Messiah in the Old Testament, is Jesus Christ. So there was a common ground there in a synagogue that they could use Scripture and point to Jesus to be the Redeemer, to be their Savior, to be their Lord, to be their Master. But you see, they're going into a city and they didn't know anybody. And they're going into a city and they just got to step in and they're going to share their faith. Do you notice here that it doesn't say that Paul and Barnabas went into this town and they lived for 6 to 9 months making friends? There's nothing wrong with friendship evangelism. There's also nothing wrong with cold door knocking. I am a great fan of all forms of evangelism. The reason? The Lord can use whatever means to save anybody, right? Whatever means. It took myself hundreds, if not thousands of times hearing the gospel before I responded. And I responded as a child. How many times did it take you to hear the gospel before you responded to the gospel? I was in church before I was born because I was in church because my mom was in church. After I was born, I was there every Sunday. And I asked when I was a kid, can I please eat during service, take the Lord's Supper? Because I like snacks. What can I say? Not much has changed. But I didn't understand the gospel. But I was still hearing the gospel. But I heard it hundreds, if not thousands of times. So for us, how do we share the gospel to people around us? Are we willing to share the gospel in the same sense that we share the gospel with people in the church? Your neighbor, if they reject it, how do you go back to him the next day? In love, in care, and in sharing? Not hurt that they rejected it, but rather you go in and you love them unto Jesus. But notice, there's a method. The method that Paul and Barnabas used was first to go into the synagogue. But if you look at that text, it says they reasoned with those in the synagogue, and both Jews and Gentiles received the word of God, which means they didn't just stop at the synagogue. They were talking when they went to the market, when they went to the gas station, when they went to their local buffet. They just continued to talk about the gospel because the gospel is what they talked about. Sharing the good news is much like sharing about what you are really excited about in life. I was told this morning that I could be on a commercial for a cereal because I was talking so excited and with so much glee about a sugar cereal. Do we talk with that much excitement and glee and enjoyment about our Savior? That you could be on a commercial for the good news that you have received in Jesus Christ. For the love and the grace and the mercy that you've received in Jesus Christ. So Paul and Barnabas, they went to Jew and Gentile. That means they went to all people. Jewish people in their heritage, and then Gentile, all that word means is the nations. Anyone who's not a Gentile. So they went to everybody else, which I'm thankful for because I'm not a Jew. And so they went and they just shared the good news. So who do we share with? Anybody and everybody we come into contact with. And they also showed intentionality in how they shared. I want to be as careful as I can with this, but if you're not intentional in sharing the gospel, you won't share the gospel. If you're not intentional, you won't share. If you're not intentional to share, you won't share. So we as a church must be intentional about sharing the gospel. This is a great opportunity for you to get plugged into our Monday night community dinner or our food pantry because we have people coming to our church. We have people who are in need. And guess what? We have a captive audience. If you would really like to learn what it is to share your faith with someone who comes to you for help, come on a Monday night and witness to people. One of my buddies, Coach T. Tavares, he came to the church, and he's been working on a new way to share the gospel just with his hand. Can I share 5 things with you, he says to the person. Sure, and then he walks through 5 different things, and those 5 things are the road to salvation. And it's just all about sharing the road to salvation with someone, that they may have ears to hear and eyes to see the good news of Jesus Christ. So we must, first and foremost, as a church, but also as individuals, be committed to sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. Are you committed to sharing the good news of Jesus Christ? Paul and Barnabas were. Second, the second commitment, boldly respond to persecution with love. How did Paul and Barnabas respond to persecution? Look at verse 3 and following of chapter 7. So this is when the Jews and the Gentiles stirred up opposition against Paul and Barnabas. So they remained a long time, that's Paul and Barnabas, speaking boldly for the Lord, who bore witness of, or witness to, the word of his grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. But the people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews, others with, and some with the apostles. When an attempt was made by both Jews and Gentiles with their rulers to mistreat them and to stone them, they learned of it and fled to Lystra, Derbe, Lyconia, and the surrounding countries. And there they continued to preach the gospel. So notice, persecution comes, and what do? They don't run from it. They plant themselves. How do they plant themselves when persecution arises? They plant themselves and they share more boldly the grace of God, and they also do signs and miracles in their midst. And we're going to get to that in a second, because there's an illustration of that in the next section of Scripture. And so they do these things, but the whole purpose of sharing about the grace of God is to point the people to Jesus. The whole reason for the signs and wonders is to point people to Jesus. The whole reason they're sharing about the Word of God is to point people to Jesus, because it's all about Jesus. But you see, the reason the persecution started is because they didn't want them to speak about Jesus. So what did they do? They boldly spoke about Jesus. So what does this look like in your life? What does this look like in your job? Have you been told you can't speak the name of Jesus in your job? Have you been told that you are connecting too much with other employees, other customers? Or have you never spoken the name of Jesus at work? Do your neighbors know you as a Christian? Or do they know you by your wife's name, by your kids' names, or by what you do? When I walk into the gym, I am called Pastor John or Rev by people who have never set foot in this church. Rev is short for Reverend, so they just wanted to make it, I guess, cool. That really helps me keep my cool when I get mad in the gym, because I'm a walking testimony for Jesus. Because just like I'm a pastor when I walk into the church, I'm still a pastor when I walk into the gym. I'm still a pastor when I go and pick up my boys from daycare. Guess what? Over being a pastor, I'm a Christian. And I have to model Christ in every facet of my life. And so what these men did is they saw persecution and they said, even in the face of that persecution, we're still Christians and we want everyone in this area to hear about the good news of Jesus Christ. So we're going to boldly proclaim it in love. And the reason I add in love there is because it's not in spite. Because they want people to hear the good news of Jesus, the hope of Jesus, the hope of salvation, to receive that washing of the blood of the Lamb. And that can only happen if their eyes are open to the good news of Jesus. So the first commitment we have is to share the good news. And then when persecution arises, which it will, we must boldly respond to that persecution with love and grace and mercy by doing what? Sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's look at the third commitment. The third commitment here is to step out in faith. This comes from verses 8 through 13. It says this. now they've traveled, or they're going to go. They fled because they fled. They're going to be stoned to death. So they fled to Lystra. And it says, verse 8, now at Lystra, there was a man sitting who could not use his feet. He was crippled from birth and never walked. He listened to Paul speaking, and Paul looked intently at him, and seeing he had faith to be made well, said in a loud voice, stand upright on your feet. And he sprang up and began walking. And when the crowd saw what Paul had done, they lifted their voices, saying in Lyconian, the gods have come down to us in the likeness of men. Barnabas, they called Zeus. Paul, they called Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. Let's just pause right there. So what we see here, notice, the third commitment is to continually step out in faith. So Paul and Barnabas, they have shared the gospel. They've boldly proclaimed the gospel even in the face of persecution. And now they're fleeing, if you will, for their life because of sharing the gospel. They come to this new town, and Paul has a captive audience in front of him. And he looks at a guy, and I don't know how he sees that this man who has been crippled, that he sees in him that he has faith to be made well. I don't know how Paul sees that, but Paul sees it. Paul had a Holy Spirit moment where the Holy Spirit revealed to him that this man has the faith to be made well. That's remarkable, because at this point he didn't believe in Jesus, but he had the faith to be made well. So Paul just calls him out and says, hey, stand up, my friend. And what does the man do? He jumps up. He leaps up. Anybody who's been hurt knows that if you've not even, like, you know, been on crutches for a month, you don't just go to leaping. I've had multiple knee surgeries. I've had multiple hip surgery. And it always takes PT, which is not my favorite. This man had never walked before. And I don't know if you've been around a newborn baby. Preston and Ashley will hopefully be around a newborn baby sometime this week, by God's grace. Those little feet will be super malleable because the muscles in them have never been used. This man's muscles were atrophied to the point that he couldn't use them because he'd never used them. And in an instant, in a moment, what happens? He can jump up. The beautiful thing here is God can do anything, but do you believe it? I want you to see how Paul had to step out in faith. Think about the faith of Paul. He's out trying to witness to people. He wants to show people that Jesus truly is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And to this whole room of people, he's going to now step out in faith and say, basically, be healed. Stand up, buddy. And if that man doesn't stand up, what does Paul look like? A clown. A buffoon. Like, he doesn't even know what he's talking about. So he, as the Christian, steps out in faith that God, who performs miracles, and the Holy Spirit was leading him to say this, that he would perform a miracle in this moment. Can I tell you something that is more miraculous than a lame man receiving his ability to walk? That you, Christian, right now would believe that someone who's not a Christian could get new life in Jesus Christ. That they could go from sinner to saint. That they can go from being lost in their trespasses to being born again, to being made new, having a new life. Jesus talks about it as being born again. To be born again, you can't enter your mother's womb. It's a supernatural experience. That is a miracle. But do you believe that even your sinner friends, your co-workers who cuss like sailors, who are fornicators and adulterers and just are living by the world's standards, do you believe that they can be saved? They can. Because our God is powerful. Our God is mighty. But do you believe it? Because if you believe it, then you'll speak to them. And not only will you speak, but you'll speak boldly. Why? Because they need the hope and the love that is found in Jesus Christ. Paul believed it to the point of saying, hey, buddy, stand up and walk. And this man got up. Do we believe it to the point that we are going to say to our coworker or our neighbor or our friend or maybe a brother or sister, hey, do you know Jesus loves you? You know, he doesn't just love you, he actually likes you. I think a lot of people in our culture need to hear that God likes them because they're looking for affirmation. Why do people do what they do? They feel like they want to be liked by the people around them. Hey, God likes you so much that he did something pretty amazing for you. He made a way for you to know him. Maybe you need to start there with your neighbor or your friend. But if you're not willing to speak, is it because you don't know what to say or you don't have the faith that God can perform a miracle? So our first commitment is to share the good news. Our second commitment is to respond boldly to persecution with love. Our third commitment is to continually step out in faith, trusting that God will do miracles. Our fourth commitment is to walk in humility. So Paul and Barnabas, they see this man. They see this man, this man gets healed by God's power through Paul. And what happens is this town, Lystra, they have a specific temple in this town, and this town believes it had been previously visited by gods. And so they believe they had been previously visited, and no one allowed them, these two gods, to stay at their homes. So they were rejected by everybody in the town of Lystra except these two really poor people. And then these two really poor people gave what they had to these gods, and then when they died, they became trees. I don't know, guys, I'm not making it up. You can read about it in history, but people are weird. To be trees, well, I guess, was a good thing back then. So the two people became trees. So they worshiped that, but they see Paul and Barnabas come in, and they're like, we're not going to make the same mistakes our forefathers made by missing an opportunity to worship two quote-unquote gods in human flesh. So I just want to paint this picture for you. A whole town and the temple priest of Jupiter is coming down, and he is going to offer sacrifices. They're going to put a wreath, so it's like a crown, on Paul and Barnabas, and they are going to be worshipped and deified. How many people want themselves to be acknowledged? How many people are so proud of what they can do for, if you will, God or for anything, that they're not going to reflect that worship and point to God, but they're going to accept the glory for themselves? I call them humble brags, because that's what pastors do. How many humble brags do you see or do you hear about? Oh, what a great day at church. We had 100 new visitors, we baptized 1,000, and we've now moved to 5 services. So what is that whole point? We had a great day at church, look what God is doing through my church. That's what happens all the time. All the time. And I really fight not to do those kind of things because I don't want to humble brag, because it's really saying, look at what God is doing through me, right? So I really try to say, no, that is all because of Jesus. It's not because of me. And I see that here in this text. Look what happens. It says this in verse 13. And the priests of Zeus, whose temple was at the entrance of the city, brought oxen and garland to the gates and wanted to offer sacrifices with the crowds. But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard it, they tore their garments and rushed into the crowds, crying out, "Men, why are you doing these things? Why also, we also are men of like nature with you, And we bring to you good news that you should turn from these vain things to a living God who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. In the past generations, he allowed all nations to walk in their own ways, yet he did not leave himself without witness, for he did good by giving you rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, satisfying your hearts with food and gladness. Even with these words, they scarcely restrained the people from offering sacrifices to them. So there's two things that I want you to see from what I just read. The first thing I want you to see is when Paul and Barnabas realized that there were that the people misunderstood the miracle and they were going to worship them as men, they tried everything in their might to get the people not to. Do not worship me. I'm just a man. Do not do that. I'm like you. Do not do that. Do we walk in that humility today? Do you live for the praise of men or do you live for the praise of God? Well done, my good and faithful servant. Or, hey, you did a really, really, really good job with that. Having other people look highly upon you. Having other people look good and be pleased with you. What do you live for? Men's applause or God's applause? Paul and Barnabas, clearly they were living and fighting for the applause of God, not the applause of man. And then the second thing, notice what they did. Do you see their tactics shifted? Where did they start in this passage? They went to the synagogue. And what did they do in the synagogue? They reasoned from Scripture. How are they reasoning now? They're seeing that the people around them know nothing of the synagogue because they're worshiping an idol. So they shouldn't reason from the Bible. They reason from nature. This is now a natural witness of the testimony of God. Hey, our God, the God of the Bible, he made the heavens and he made the earth. He made the seas and all that is in them. Worship this God. He's made a way for you. Turn from these vain gods. Turn from this God. This isn't real. Turn to the one true God. And he used natural revelation. The rain from heaven, the fruitful land that has come to them and for them. He used that to be a witness of the testimony of God for them to win people to Jesus. This is knowing your audience, sharing the good news of God to those. But you see, they are so committed to walking in humility, they're not going to receive the glory that is only given to God, because even through this opportunity to walk in humility, they are doing what? Pointing the people who are worshiping a false God to the one true God, using whatever means necessary. They are committed to walk in humility. They're committed to step out in faith. They're committed to respond to persecution in love, and they're committed to share Jesus because that's all they're doing. The fifth commitment is never give up on your God-given mission. Never give up on your God-given mission. Look at verse 19. This is crazy. But the Jews from Antioch and from Iconium, and having persuaded the crowds, they stoned Paul. They dragged him out of the city, supposing that he was dead. The disciples gathered about him. He rose up and entered the city. Okay, I just want to pause. Okay, why would they stone Paul? Because he did not accept their worship, and so they were treating him as a blasphemer. So they dragged him out of the city. And how did they stone somebody, you might ask? It's not throwing a stone like we would play catch. Normally, you would push an individual off a cliff, okay, so that when they fall, they break their legs so they don't move. Or they get knocked out when they hit their head on the ground. Because a moving target is harder to hit. So they push them off a cliff because the whole purpose of stoning is to do what? Kill a guy. You're not trying to hit a guy. You're trying to kill him. So push him off a cliff. He's down like 15, 20 feet. Everybody picks up a stone, not a small stone, a big stone, and they do what? They're chunking on him. So it's raining down stones. And it's raining down enough stones on Paul that what does the crowd presume? Him to be dead. Do you think that they've stoned people before? Yes. Do you think they know what a dead man looks like after being stoned? Yes. So did Paul die? Possibly. But here's all I'm going to say here. God can do anything, and the only way this man hopped up and went back into the same town is if the Holy Spirit did a miraculous healing work, whether he was dead or whether he was knocked out and got hit with a bunch of stones. God performed a miracle. What did Paul do? What do you do when you're like slandered? What do you do when you're just rejected by people? What do you do? Do you turn the other cheek? Do you say, all right, you hit me good here, hit me again? What does Paul do in this? He just got stoned to death. And what does he do? He gets up and goes back into town. How crazy would this have been? Imagine, there's a whole group of people. They're all at the local buffet. They're just eating, and it's an open-air buffet. So they're eating, and they're like, yeah, we just killed that guy. I'm glad we got rid of him. He was causing a stir here in the synagogue and the marketplace. And they look up from their bite, and then they see Paul walking back in. They think they saw a ghost. What was Paul doing? I believe that Paul was demonstrating the love of God. And before we go to our last commitment, I just want to hone in on this point. When we say John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life, I want you to think about this. Haven't you done enough sin for God not to love you? Haven't you committed enough unfaithfulness in your relationship to him? That's what sin is. Whether it's lack of belief, whether it's breaking any of the Ten Commandments or the other 630 commandments in the Old Testament, how many times have you sinned against God and you have given him an opportunity to say, man, yeah, that dude is broke. And how does God respond to you? God looks at you just like he looks at me and says, I love you. Believe in my son. You have given God every opportunity not to love you, yet he loves you. Paul was given every opportunity not to love the people of the city. They threw stones at him to kill him. And what did he do? He got back up and went into the city to display God's love to people who need to know God, to show them what? You don't like me, but my message is true. You don't love me and tried to kill me, but my message is true. You need to believe in Jesus because he's the only way. And I believe that so much, I'm going to come back to you after you've just done this to me to share the message of God with you. Never give up on your mission. No matter how many times people tell you no, no matter how many times you're rejected, never give up because you don't know what's going on in the person's life that you're sharing with. Paul didn't give up on these people, but guess what? Even more so, God hasn't given up on you and God hasn't given up on them, so you shouldn't either. So the first commitment we've seen is share the good news of Jesus. The second commitment we've seen is boldly respond to the persecution with love. The third commitment we've seen is step out in faith. Fourth, walk in humility. Fifth, never give up to your God-given commission. And fifth, strengthen believers. Strengthen believers. What does Paul do? He now travels backwards through his missionary journey, after being stoned, after having to flee another town, after being pushed out of these towns, what does he do? He loves the church and he loves the non-believers in those cities so much that he travels back through every one of them to go back to the sending church that sent him. Why? Because he still had work to do in each of those churches and in each of those cities. If you look at this text, what it says, if you look there with me, he says, verse 20, but when he But when the disciples gathered about him, he rose up and entered the city. And on the next day, he and Barnabas went to Derbe. And when they had preached the gospel to that city and had many and made many disciples, they returned to Lystra, Iconium, and to Antioch, strengthening the souls of the disciples, encouraging them to continue in their faith by saying that through many tribulations we must enter the kingdom of God. And when they had appointed elders for them in every church with prayer and fasting, they committed them to the Lord in whom they had believed. When they had passed through Pisidia and Pamphylia, and they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Attalia, and from there they sailed to Antioch, where they had been commended to the grace of God for the work that they had fulfilled. Verse 27, and when they arrived and gathered the church together, they declared all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles, and they remained there no little time with the disciples, encouraging the disciples. The whole point of that entire section is this. They not only preached the gospel, but they went back and encouraged those who believed. They strengthened those who believed. They edified those who believed. They appointed leaders for the churches that they planted. They helped these people, and they showed them. They were, if you will, living illustrations that if you walk with Jesus, you will face hard times. But guess what? If you persevere, if you hold on in faith, continuing to step out in faith, God will provide. They were illustrations. You can do that because we've done it. You can do it. So, church, here's the sermon today. You can do it because we've done it. This church has been here for 105 years. We have much more gospel ministry to do. And God has a big plan for this church. But we must be committed to these six things. When we gather on Sundays, we are here to strengthen other believers. We don't talk bad about other people. We don't talk bad about people outside the church. We don't talk bad about people inside the church. We love each other. Why? Jesus loved you, and you're called to love your neighbor as yourself. We want to edify and encourage and strengthen the body of believers. And then we want to go out from this place and be sent into our local area that God has placed us and positioned us in this life to do what? Make disciples. How do you do that? Speak the gospel. Share the gospel. What do you do when persecution arises? Share boldly with love. Not proving you're right, but sharing the love of Jesus with people who need to know Jesus. Step out in faith continually as you're doing that. Walk in humility as you share. Never give up on your God-given mission, no matter how they respond to you. And do what? As you share, as you go, as you do, edify the saints, build up the church, and we will see God move in a powerful way. We have a great opportunity here at Exchange Avenue Baptist Church to see God move. See the Holy Spirit just lavish exponential amounts of grace upon us as we seek to make disciples here in this area. And hopefully send people all around the world. Hopefully see churches revitalized, churches planted from the ministry here. That's my prayer. Are you dreaming big dreams? Are you praying big prayers? Do you believe that God can perform miracles? If you're here today, you've never placed your faith and trust in Christ, Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the life. Jesus is the only way to heaven. He said it. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. None of us are good enough to go to the Father. None of us are holy enough. You can't give enough money to any church, even if you're Jeff Bezos. Don't have enough money. The only way to heaven, the only way to satisfaction, the only way to new life is by Jesus. Do you need Jesus today? Are you still under the penalty of your sin? Or are you walking free, free, forever, amen, when death was arrested and your life began? I want to introduce you to Jesus. If you've never met him, if you've never given your life to him, we're going to have a time of response. I'd love to introduce you to my Jesus, my Lord, and my Savior. If you'd like to join this church, this is a time to come and just share with me. We have a process for joining the church. You have to take a new membership class. It's really just a get-to-know-you class, because we want you to know us and us to know you before you join us. But if you'd like to be baptized or you need prayer, I would be honored as your pastor to pray with you. Of course, honored to baptize you as you walk out your faith with Jesus Christ. As the band makes their way forward, worship continues through response. We've heard and sat under the preaching of the word. All of us must respond to this. The question at hand is, how must you respond? Do you need to respond by giving your life to Jesus? Do you need to respond by committing to share the gospel, by changing your method of how to share the gospel, by writing down those six commitments and saying, I'm going to remind myself of these each day that God has made, that I will live as a sent one to change the world that God has sent me to? Will you stand as I pray? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. We thank you, Lord, for the word that we have heard today. Help us, O God, to faithfully fulfill the call you've placed upon our life by committing to be disciples who are disciple makers. It's all about Jesus. I pray, Lord, in every interaction that we have with family, with friends, with coworkers, with neighbors, that we would make it all about Jesus. And even the people who are hard to love during the holiday seasons, we would still love them because Jesus loves us. And at times we're difficult to love. May we be that example to everyone. Jesus with skin on. Lord, if there be someone here today who does not know you as their Lord and Savior, may they put their faith and trust in you. And may they respond this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll respond as the Lord leads.
Be thou thou art. King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Amen. You may be seated. As we conclude this morning, it is Thanksgiving week, which means there's a lot to catch you guys up on as we go into this holiday week. First and foremost, like it was on our schedule today to have our food pantry packing. As John mentioned earlier in the service, thanks to our students and John's Sunday school class, that's already taken care of. So we don't have to worry about doing that today. That's already prepared for our food pantry. And our food pantry is tomorrow at 3:30 p.m. This is an awesome, awesome opportunity, as John mentioned a couple times during our service today, to put action to our faith, be intentional with how we speak to others, and speak to others to share the gospel with them and point them towards the hope that is found in Christ Jesus. So that's tomorrow from 3:30 to 5:30 p.m. We'd love to have you serve in that way. As soon as we dismiss here this morning, it's a good day because we have food today. And we have food in the fellowship hall, in the gym, excuse me, and it's our Thanksgiving potluck today. So that's an exciting day each and every year. So as soon as we dismiss here in a minute, I'm going to pray for us. As soon as we dismiss, you can make your way over there. Give it just a couple minutes to make sure everything is all set up and ready to go. And then we'll start eating some lunch pretty soon. We hope you stay for some fellowship time in that today. Looking ahead to this week, beginning on Tuesday, our offices are going to be closed in honor of the holiday, so just keep that in mind, beginning on Tuesday. So we'll be open tomorrow as well for our food pantry and Monday night dinner, and then we will be closed for the remainder of the week after that. As always, you'll have the opportunity before you go today to give of tithes and offerings. Let us continue to be faithful in that as we push towards the end of 2023. I want to invite you where you are to stand with me. I'm going to pray for us, and then we will be dismissed. And we hope to see you over in the fellowship hall today for some fellowship and food. Let us pray together. Lord, we're grateful once again for how you've moved in power today. May you be known by the way that we live our life. May other people see you as we point them towards you. And may we be intentional. May we have hearts that are willing to be intentional. And even when it's difficult, Lord, may we love and may we share of the good that is found only in you. Bless this time that we get to spend together this morning and this afternoon through our Thanksgiving meal. Lord, we're grateful for all that you've done for us. Would you use us as we go? We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a wonderful Sunday afternoon, everybody. To Jesus for his cleansing power. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you fully trusting his graceless power?
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow while he washed in the blood of the Lamb. Be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood?